realize, church, we have no hope.
Amen.
But he is our hope.
Yes, he is.
He has made a way.
He has.
And he continues to make a way for all.
Yes, he does.
It's up to us whether we'll receive him. It's up to us whether we're going to keep him.
Right.
It's up to us whether we're going to serve him.
Amen, amen.
Our only hope is in Jesus. There is no hope in this world at all. And I am so thankful. You may be seated. Special prayer request for Sister Sally, that God will continue to touch her.
Amen.
Touch her body and her mind in Jesus' name. She realizes that he is her hope.
Amen.
That's for sure. For Brother Alan. Also, a special prayer for Sister Kate. She's in South Carolina on vacation. That God will protect her with this late storm, in Jesus' name, that God will calm that storm, in Jesus' name. Does anyone have any prayer requests? Brother Bill, good to see you.
Thank you. Prayers for Michelle's health and of course the baby's self. And when you become first-time parents, there's a lot of joy. But sometimes it can come with frustration, lack of sleep. And just other things in life that you have to deal with. So I pray that Michelle and I can remain strong and not let any frustration impact the baby.
Amen.
Amen.
The
baby will get a
spiritual
Jesus. That will help you live. Jesus. Brother Mike?
My son Andrew, my brother Charlie, also for Antonio and Aaron, and also for Jessica and Justin and
then. Anyone else? Sister Carol?
I can't see what she's looking at here.
God is doing something in Amy's life. Yeah, we've been praying for her because of her son's situation, and it's a special place to be. And God, it looks like God has provided it. I want to give God the glory.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
Also, brother, thank you. We've got an appointment for Ange.
Thank you, Lord.
And the shorts has went through. It's taken 2 years. God is good. So I'm thankful for that.
Yes.
Amen. Brother Sean, Jessica.
Pray for her mom so she can feel better when she comes to church.
Amen. For Sister Rebecca, is her bird. She's a feel well.
Yes.
Brother Sean.
Also, for my son, for Joshua. That he gets in here.
Yeah.
Starts taking church seriously.
Yes.
Amen.
Not all our young people will be faithful.
Oh. Well, sorry, one more thing. I just thought. Also, that our youth group can grow again. Because we're dwindling again, and I want a packed house.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Jesus' name.
Yes,
boy. Anyone up here?
Just want to pray for all those that are out today that are sick, not doing well. Something about the rain can cause ailments to the bodies, too. So this God, just watch over you.
Sister Mother,
just for my children, I just want to call down all skin and pray for our life groups and for our backsliders.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise God. Pray for the governments around this world. There's a lot of things going on. Armenia is 120,000 people are at the place where genocide is about to take place if some people don't have it. And so the world's in dire need.
Yes.
And the solution is Jesus.
It is.
Amen.
It is Jesus.
And so please pray for the governments around the world. Pray for God to intervene. It has to take place with the rapture. Let it happen.
Yes.
Because the world is spiraling out of control, it seems like. But we have the hope of Christ.
Good.
And so we need to stay strong in the Lord. This is not a time to be weak. This is not a time to flounder in your spiritual needs. Amen. This is a time to call out to God. So pray for God to intervene. Pray for our friend examine day coming up. And also for our All Nation Sunday.
Yes. Amen. Don't forget your hope. Yes. We all have a hope in Jesus. Yes. Amen. Yes. Good to see you both here today.
Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank
if you have any special needs, please come up front. But come up believing that God is going to touch and move in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Jesus, we love you and we thank you, dear Lord God.
Thank
you.
Everyone needs forgiveness.
Good to see you.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Amen. God is good all the time.
Hi.
John, click on the thing on the bottom to make it big again. There we go. I got it. Now, make it. Thank you, brother. Praise God. So good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
God bless.
Good to see Kevin in the house today. Amen. God is good. And this is the perfect day for this message. Amen. God knows what he's doing. I'm going to be preaching today, amen, on Celebrate Recovery. We're getting ready to start Celebrate Recovery in January. Amen. And I want everybody to understand that everyone needs recovery. Look at your neighbor and tell them you need recovery. Amen. Now, everybody might not understand that, because everybody thinks recovery is just for the drug addict or for the alcoholic. But that's not what recovery is all about. We all need recovery, because we all have things within our life. Amen. Praise God. So I'm going to be reading today from Isaiah 57. All right, you ready?
Make a competition.
There you go. 57, 7 through 18. And I'm going to read it from two different versions this morning. Praise God. The Bible says, "For the iniquity of his covetousness was I wroth, and I smote him." Now this is God talking. "I hid me and was wroth, and he went on forward in the way of his heart." Now, I don't know if that needs explanation or not, but this is someone who went wayward. This is someone who was doing their own thing. They were trying to fill the lust of their own heart. They were doing what pleased them. But I want you to see the next verse, because the next verse says, God again speaking, "I have seen his ways and will heal him. I will lead him also and restore comforts unto him and to his mourners." Amen. That last portion of that, and where it says, "And I will comfort him and to his mourners," because things in our life affect other people.
Yeah.
Amen. And so you might think that what you do doesn't bother anybody else. This is my life. I'll do what I want to do. But the scripture tells us different. If it's making someone else mourn, if it's making someone else sad, if it's breaking someone else's heart, God says, "I'm going to restore and comfort not only the person, but his mourners." Amen. Now I'm going to read it from the Amplified. John, you're going to have to help me here, my clicker ain't working. Which really isn't the Amplified, because I didn't have the Amplified in my program. So I'm going to read it, actually the Good News translation. I just tried it again. There it is, it's working now. We're good. I shut it off and turned it back on. Thank you, John. But it says, "Because of the iniquity of his covetousness and unjust gain." That's the Amplified. Here's the Good News. "I was angry with them because of their sin and greed." Notice the two things that God was angry with: sin, but then he points out greed. Amen. "And so I punished them and abandoned them." See, when we go out on our own way, amen,
We're on our own.
Right.
God said he abandoned them. But they were stubborn and kept on going their own way. God, the reason why God abandoned was trying to get them to call out to God. Amen?
Amen.
But then verse 18 again gives us hope. I have seen how they acted, but I will heal them. Despite our actions, despite our bad habits, God said, I will lead them and help them and will comfort those who mourn. Praise God. Father, Lord, help me today to bring this message, God,
yes,
of hope, Lord,
yes, God,
of recovery, of strength, Lord God. God, let us understand it, Lord God, and let us apply it to our life, Lord, that we can begin, God, the healing process within,
yes,
our lives.
Yes.
We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. The road to recovery begins today. Amen. It begins, maybe your road has begun already. And of course, if you're filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in Jesus' name, you have made a great start. Amen.
Amen.
But there's still things within us as Christians. We see it as we study the Bible. Last Thursday night, we were studying about David and his family and the dysfunction that took place in his family because of a failure to address some things. Well, that's what happens in all of our lives. When we ignore symptoms and when we ignore things within our lives, nothing changes. Amen. And so it's amazing how much better the world looks. Amen. When your person is put together in the right way. And you're going to understand what I mean by that as I tell this next story, praise God, because I believe that it brings together that image that I just tried to relate about us coming together, being whole. There was a father who wanted to take a nap in the afternoon after Sunday service. But he had a young son. Amen. And so he was in his living room laying on the couch and his little boy kept bugging him saying, Daddy, I'm bored. Daddy, I'm bored. And so the father, thinking that he could find something to keep his son occupied so he could take his nap, found a picture of a globe in the newspaper. And he ripped it all up into 50 different pieces. And he said to his son, Son, this is a puzzle. Now he knew his son didn't know geography that well. So he thought, this is going to keep me busy for a while and I'll be able to get my nap. Amen. I like his thinking. Praise God. And so he ripped it up into these 50 pieces and said, this is a puzzle. Amen. He said, I want you to put it all back together again. So he gave these 50 pieces to his son. He laid down on his couch to finish his nap, thinking he'd be at least another half hour, maybe two, if he's lucky, and get some sleep. But in about 15 minutes, the little boy woke up saying, Daddy, I've got to finish. It's all put together. His father woke up and said, You're kidding me. How could you get it done so fast? How could you complete that? He knew, again, that his son didn't know the nations or the geography, amen, or the positions of the nations. And so he said, you know, I don't understand how you were able to do this, son. He said, Dad, there was a picture of a person on the back page of that map. Amen. And so when I was able to get the face and the person put back together, the whole world came together. Isn't that true, though? If we could put people back together, how much better would the world be? How much better would it be, amen, if we could just get people fixed, praise God. Hallelujah. So that verse that I read, as I told you earlier, is God speaking. Amen. He saw how we act. He sees how we hurt. He sees the things that are necessary. And he tries to lead us, but because we fail to listen sometimes, we fail to act on the things that God wants to give us, God abandons us and we're on our own. Amen. But God does that to get our attention. We can see that over and over again in the stories in the Old Testament. Amen. But then God says, I'll lead and help them. I'll comfort them. And I'll bring those that mourn with them. And I offer peace to all that are near and far. What a great promise we have in God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Notice that there are five parts to recovery in this, just these couple verses that I've just read. And I'm going to give that to you right here. They're listed on the screen. Amen. And here are the five things. If you've been hurt, I want you to understand that God wants to heal you. How many in here are hurting right now over something in their life? Amen. Praise God. We all have hurts, don't we? Family problems, situations in life that hurt, amen, very deeply. Praise God. He also, if you're confused, God wants to lead us. You ever been to the place where you don't understand what's going on or why it's going on? What is that? That's confusion. God wants to lead us out of confusion. God's not the author of confusion. That's what the adversary does. He wants us to be confused, the adversary does. But God wants to lead us. Amen. Praise God. If you feel helpless to change. Anybody ever feel helpless to change? Come on, be honest here today. Because that's how we get our healing. By first of all, recognizing our faults. Recognizing those things in our life. Amen. Well, if you feel hopeless, guess what? God wants to help you change. God doesn't want you to feel helpless. God wants to be your help.
Right.
Amen? Praise God. If you feel no one understands, you ever felt like that?
Yes.
Nobody understands what I'm going through. Nobody understands what the pain is like. Nobody understands the draw of the addiction. Nobody understands the hurt from the family. Nobody understands what you're going through. Amen. God wants to comfort you. Hallelujah. Amen. And if you feel anxious or worried and afraid, and let me tell you, the world we live in today, fear is a great factor in people's lives. Let me say that again. Fear is a great factor in people's lives. And so if you're feeling anxious because of everything that's happening in the world, in our government, maybe in your home, maybe in your work, amen. No matter where it is, it kind of brings a place of being afraid, amen. But God wants to bring you peace. Believe that. Look at your neighbor and say, I believe it. God wants to do all these things. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. The fact is that life is tough. We all go through things. We all have situations that we got to face. We all have a family member who sometimes just drives us nuts. Right? Amen. We have parents that are divorced and the hurts of that and the loss of that all affects us. Amen. And so we live in a perfect world. We live in a fallen world. A world that, amen, brings hurt. And we're hurt by other people. We're hurt by ourselves. and we hurt other people ourselves.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
The Bible says this, that all have sinned. Everyone sitting in this room has sinned. Amen. Now, I don't think God really categorizes sin. Sin is sin in God's eyes. God doesn't like sin, does he?
Right.
Amen. And so, that means none of us are perfect. We all have faults. We all have failures. We've all blown it at some time within our life. And we've made mistakes and we hurt other people in the process. Right? Amen. Hurt people, that is true. Everyone in this room needs recovery. Oh, not me, I'm a Christian. Not me, I'm full of the Holy Ghost. Liar, liar, pants on fire. Amen. Praise God. Amen. I haven't lived a perfect life. I don't think anybody in this room has lived the perfect life. Amen. And so, because of that, if you've ever been hurt, if you've ever had a hang-up or a habit that you'd like to get rid of, then you need recovery. It's that simple. It doesn't have to be drugs or alcohol. Amen. There is so many things that affect us. Amen. And so, we have to ask the question, well, what do we need recovery from? Well, the good news is this. Regardless of the problem, you need recovery from things emotional, financial, relational, spiritual, sexual, and the list could go on and on. Amen? Praise God. The steps of recovery, though, are always the same. You're not going to change that. Amen. There's something that we have to do. You know, back in 1935, there was a couple of guys, amen, that formulated the basis of recovery based on Scripture. That's what it was based on. It was based on Scripture. And from that, amen, came the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous to deal with an alcohol problem in people's lives. But you know what? The same things work for every other hangup. Because they're based on Scripture. You have to go back to the Word of God. The Word of God is creative. The Word of God is powerful. The Word of God, the Bible says, is quick and powerful. And sharper than any two-edged sword, right? And so it has a way of cutting away the things that are hurting us in life. Amen. Praise God. So, I put together some principles based on other recoveries, anecdotes, if you would. And the first step, we're gonna break it down into an acronym. And so, the word recovery is that acronym. And so, the R in acronym is this. This is the first step to recover. Everybody, it's on your list. You can fill out your paper. Because here comes your first answer. Amen. Realize that I'm not God. Speaking of yourself. You're not God. I'm not God. Amen. That's the first step in recovery. You have to realize you're not God.
Right.
I have to realize I'm not God. I'm not in control, even though I want to be in control. And see, that's the biggest problem. We want to be in control. Right?
Yes.
Amen. And so we have to admit that we're powerless. Amen. We don't have the power to overcome some things within our life. We need the power of the Holy Ghost within our life. Amen. To overcome problems. Praise God. Now, just because you have the Holy Ghost doesn't mean everything goes away.
Right.
And this is where a lot of Christians go wrong, because they get saved and they accept Christ and they get baptized in Jesus' name and they get filled with the Holy Ghost, they think, well, praise God, I'm fixed. Mm. Doesn't work like that. No. There's still some things you have to do.
Right.
Amen? Praise God. How many of you ever stayed up late at night when you know you need sleep? So you come to church on Sunday morning and you're falling asleep in the pew, not because the preacher's boring, although that might be the case, amen, but it's because we don't discipline ourselves in the right way. We don't do the things that we know we should do.
Right?
Right? Yeah. What is that? That's a control problem. Amen. We want to be in control. You ever eat and drink more than your body needs?
Oh, yes.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. We can go on down the list. You ever know that something's wrong, but you do it anyway? Now, I shouldn't be doing this. Right? But you do it anyway. Sister Gordon was teaching Sunday school today, and she was talking about the battling of the giants. How David had to, you know, battle that giant. And he went with confidence to do it. And we talked about in that Sunday school class about sometimes we don't have the confidence that we really should have. And so we just go along with the flow. And she said something that I've preached many a time, but this is the battlefield right here.
Amen.
This is the battlefield. The devil would love to get you thinking that you can't do something or that this crisis is too big. But I've got a God that's bigger than anything the devil wants to bring. Amen.
Amen.
Have you ever tried to control somebody or something and find out that you can't? How many parents are in the house? Raising kids, you ever just like, oh my Lord, what am I going to do? Right? So, if you've answered any of these questions with yes, welcome to the human race. Welcome to the fallen world that we live in. You know what the Bible says this, and it has a word for it. The Bible has a word for this. The Bible calls that tendency my sin nature. That's an answer inside the pamphlet that I handed out. That's your sin nature. And just because we got saved doesn't mean we don't fight that nature anymore. Right? We have a sin nature. We battle things within our mind. We battle the things of this world and we battle the things of the devil. That's the three battle fronts right there.
Yeah.
Amen. The flesh, the world, and the devil.
Oh, yeah.
And they come against every one of us. Amen.
Oh, yeah.
You try to change your life and what's it do? And you know, I'll give you a good test. Tell yourself, I'm going to fast this week. Watch how many invites you get to go to lunch. Right? It never fails. You know, you say, I'm going to fast, and somebody wants to take you out to eat.
Oh, yes.
Right? These things happen all the time. Now, maybe that's a simple illustration, but it's true to life. Amen. When you try to stop something comes in and says, the world comes in and says, hey, but there's this over here that you can do and it'll be fun.
Oh, yes.
The flesh says, but I like doing it. I don't want to give it up. I like that feeling. Right?
Oh, yes.
Amen. And so our sin nature gets me and you in all kinds of problems. What was it that caused David to sin and have a man killed on the battlefield? It was lust. It was his flesh.
Oh, yes.
Amen. And so we see oftentimes that we respond in the wrong way when we're hurt. Amen. And it just increases the hurt rather than lessening it. We try to do things to appease ourselves, to comfort ourselves. And the only one who can really bring us comfort is the Lord Jesus Christ.
Right.
Amen?
Yes.
And so, praise God, we react the wrong way to people. We treat them in a wrong way, and then it backfires. Right? Or maybe you're brutally honest with a friend. And because you're brutally honest and you bring them their faults to the front, that they no longer are your friend. That hurts, doesn't it? Amen. Proverbs 4:12 tells us this. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man. It may seem right, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Right? Amen. See, you always have the cynic with you until the rapture takes place. Oh, we have the power to overcome. God said he'll always make a way of escape. But it's up to us to take the escape route. It's up to you to make the right choice. It's up to you to know the Word of God. It's up to you to pray. It's up to you to fast. It's up to you to do the things that are necessary to be an overcomer in Christ.
Right.
Amen. Paul understood this. When you read the writings of Paul in the book of Romans, Paul in Romans 7:15, he says, "For that which I do, I allow not. For that I would that I do not. But what I hate, that do I." The battle is real. The struggle between the flesh and the spirit is real. Amen. It's a spiritual battle. You know, I don't know how many of you ever thought about this. But the Bible talks about the book of Revelations, the mark of the beast. Now, men have tried to figure that out for centuries. Is it a literal mark? Or is it something that just marks humanity? Six is the number of humanity. Six is the number of completion. Amen. And six is very significant in Scripture. And so could it be that the mark of the beast is that there would be just a very humanistic view in the world in the end times that it would take over and be so strong that it would take over everything from financial all the way into government and dictating to every human being through a humanistic view what's going to happen. Something to think about, isn't it? Amen. And so the battle is real, and the struggle between our flesh and spirit is real. And it probably sounds very familiar to many of us in this world today. Amen. We end up doing what we don't want to do. Right? Just like Paul. I go to do good, evil is present with me. Right? And so the first step to recovery is we've got to understand the cause of the problem. Why does this happen in our lives? Why do we allow? Why do we need, amen, to do some of the things that we end up doing, it seems like? Well, the cause of it and the consequences of the problem, we have to realize, and then we'll find the cure. Amen. So what's the cause of the problem? Well, we want to put ourselves at the center of the universe. You want to make every decision. You want to be in control. You want to be the boss. You want to do everything that appeases what you think is right. What I think is right. Right?
Right.
Amen. We don't want anybody telling me what to do in my life. Who are they? Do they know better? You know what that is? That's called playing God.
Right.
That's what it is. Amen. And so, I want to be in control. You want to be in control. And we're all insecure of who we really are. Amen. Praise God. And so, in your notes, we want to be in control. And how do we play God? By denying or by denying our humanity, in a sense. By trying to play God, right? And by trying to control everything for selfish reasons. I'll put that on the screen. By denying our humanity, by trying to control everything for selfish reasons. Because that's what I want. So we want to be at the center of the universe. We want to control the issues. Right? We want to try to control ourselves. We want to try to control others. And we want to control everything around us. Right? So how do we play God? Well, we try to control our image of who we are. Try to look like something that we're really not. We need to take off the masks, in other words. Amen. And let our real self be seen. Let's be open and honest with one another. The Bible says that we're to confess our faults one to another. But we don't see that happening a lot, do we? Why? Because we want to be in control of our image. If I shared this with somebody else, oh my God, what would they think? It's not the point of what they think. It's about getting together and praying for one another. It's about getting together and addressing the hurts and the habits and the things that try to control us. So we got to take off the mask. Amen. Praise God. We don't want people to see the real us. Why I'm afraid to tell people what I'm going through. How many times do you come into the house of God and you're battling a battle and somebody asks you, how you doing today? Oh man, everything's fine. I'm blessed. But inside is turmoil. Why can't we just be honest and say, you know, I'm really struggling today. I'm going through some things. Can you pray for me? Right? I'm trying to be as transparent as I can be here. Because I believe that we could be stronger Christians if we would apply some of the things that we should be applying to our life. We try to control other people. Amen. We try to control kids. Kids try to control parents. Wives try to control husbands. Husbands try to control their wives. Right? People try to control other people. Amen. And when it doesn't happen, it causes anger. It causes resentment.
Right.
It causes envy. It causes strife. We try to control problems. Amen. You think that I can handle it? I can do this by myself. Amen. I don't need help. We try to control our pain. Amen. Why a lot of people go to places that do pain management. Pain comes when we realize in our quiet moments we're not God. We can't control everything. And that's very scary for a lot of people. So the first step to recovery is realize you're not God. That you're not supposed to be in control. He wants to be in control.
Yep.
He wants to take our burdens. He wants to carry our weights. Amen. Praise God. So, what are the consequences? What are the consequences of playing God? Well, the first one is fear. Fear, when I try to control everything, I get afraid. And that's scriptural. Look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 10. Yeah. And he said, I heard the voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself.
Right.
He realized at that moment, Adam realized right at that moment, I'm not in control anymore. Mm. And what did he do? He ran and hid. Amen. We're afraid. Amen. Right, the second one is this. Frustration. It's frustrating trying to be the general manager of the universe. You aren't called to be that. I wasn't called to be that. But we like to be, don't we?
Yes.
Amen. How many of you ever went to a park and played one of those games called whack-a-mole? Mm-hmm. The things keep popping up and you keep trying to hit them down. That's what we do in life. Things keep popping up and instead of addressing them, we just want to whack it back down and let it be hidden. But guess what? Another one pops back up and then you got to hit this one and that one and that one. And so we're always playing whack-a-mole.
Yeah.
What's that do? It brings frustration. Because you can't hit them all. Amen. And they don't stay down.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that like life? Think about it. Amen. Praise God. Paul realized that it seemed to be a fact of life that when I want to do what's right, evil is present with me. That's what he said, right? David understood it. He said, my dishonesty made me miserable.
Right.
And filled my days with frustration. That's what David said. Amen. So if you're frustrated, amen, it's a symptom of a deeper problem that you have not dealt with in your life somewhere along the line. Amen? The root issue. Got to get down to the root. You're not God. But you're trying to control everything and it doesn't work. And what's that do? It brings frustration. Romans 7:21. Find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. Number three is this. Fatigue. Ever wonder why you're so tired all the time? It's tiring playing God and trying to control everything. You wear yourself out. Trying to change something you can't change.
Yeah.
It's funny, in marriage you see it a lot. Man, everybody's on their best behavior while they're dating. Right? You're doing everything to please your honeymoon. You're opening doors and shutting doors. You're doing all that stuff, right? But after you get married, you're trying to change the individual to be what you want them to be instead of accepting them as they are and realizing you can't change anybody. But love covers a multitude of sin, right? Amen. So we just got to love one another. Keep doing the door opening. Keep doing the things that you're supposed to be doing. Amen. Praise God. that God would help us through all this stuff. And it won't be so tiring when we're trying to change something because we can't change it. Yeah. Amen. The Bible says in Psalms 32, 4 and 5, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture turned into the drought of summer. Selah, think about that for a minute. He said, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Once he confessed, it wasn't as tiring anymore, was it? You came clean. You did what was right. Fourth one is failure. When you try to play God, that's one job description, you're guaranteed to fail. And I'm guaranteed to fail. We can't play God. Proverbs 28:13 says, he that covers his sin shall not prosper. Doesn't say he might not. It says he shall not. Amen? But, thank God for the but. But whosoever confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. Amen. You know, here in Abundant Life, I believe it's important, praise God, that we be committed to becoming that safe place that people feel comfortable. That they can talk and share, amen, hurts and failures and things in their life without being condemned. Without feeling like, well, if I let the pastor know, if I let one of the leaders know, if I let my brother or sister know, what are they going to think of me? I think we need to be committed to not thinking evil of anybody, but to praying and helping one another to recover what the devil's trying to steal. Amen?
Yep. Amen?
Praise God. And so there's not a person in this room that has it all together. Amen?
Amen.
We're all weak in different areas. We all need each other. Praise God.
We do.
Amen. I need you. You need me. Praise God. We all need encouragement once in a while.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. And in fact, we need each other because we become mirrors to reveal each other's hurts and help each other. Amen. Many times others see things that I don't see, and vice versa. Right?
Amen.
Two ways, amen, that we can react. Amen. Here's some excuses that we find oftentimes. Amen. We compare ourselves to others and we say things and think things like, my problem's not that bad. That's called denial. That's what it's called. And I'm not talking about a river in Egypt.
That's right.
Amen. How bad does it have to get before you admit that you need some help? How bad does it have to get, amen, that hurt, that relationship, that pain, that problem, that memory, do you admit that, man, I just need to talk to somebody? Praise God. Unfortunately, it's human behavior. Amen. And human nature. That we never change until our pain becomes greater than the fear of change. Let me say that again. We never change until our pain becomes greater than the fear of change. We don't change when we see the light. We change when we feel the heat. Amen.
It's true.
You start changing when you start seeing your marriage falling apart.
It's true.
You start changing when you think you're going to lose your job.
Yeah.
Start changing when you think that everything's going to fall apart in life. That's why oftentimes you'll hear people say, well, they got to hit rock bottom. And it's so true.
It's true.
You're not going to change until you have no other choice. Amen. And so what's the cure? What is the cure? The first step on the road to recovery is to admit your powerlessness. When you realize this is something I can't do by myself. And this is even harder here in America because of our self-sufficient culture. That's why we have so many people hurting in the world today. Because we live in a culture that says we're self-sufficient. We can do it, right? Pull yourself up from your bootstraps. You can get over this. Just get up and go forward. No, sometimes we need help. Sometimes we need to confess. Sometimes we need prayer. Sometimes we need to get before the altar and just break down before God and say, God, I don't know what to do.
Amen.
And so the first step to getting your act together, amen, is coming to that place, admitting that I'm not God. What's that mean? It means that I recognize three important facts of life. That maturity comes when you recognize these three facts of life. Number one, I'm powerless to change my past. Your past is the past. That's why it's called the past. There's nothing you can do about the past. You can only change your future through Christ. Amen? Secondly, you need to admit that I am powerless to control other people. Amen. You know, it's funny. As a pastor, I'm going to be very transparent here. So I hope you don't get offended. But as a pastor, when somebody calls me up and says, I'm sick, I can't make it to church today, I feel like saying, if it was a work day and you had to go to work, would you be calling in sick or would you be going to work? Because your paycheck's connected to that. I'm being honest. It's easier to say I'm not going to church than it is easier to say, look, I can't take off work today. I need money. Right? There you go. They owe me or owe mine. Amen. Number two, I admit that I'm powerless to control other people. I try, but I can't. You know, some people use manipulation to get what they want. Amen. They try all kinds of gimmicks. Right? And so these are things that we need to understand. And then thirdly, I admit that I'm powerless to cope with my harmful habits, behaviors, and actions. You know, because of hurts, because of failures, because of the things that we've experienced in life, a lot of times we develop bad habits. Why does the drug addict do drugs? To cover up something? Why does the alcohol do it? Get drunk and try to forget everything because they don't want to remember their past. Why do we do certain things in life that we do, these habits that we form in life? Because it's a reflection of something else that has taken place within our life. James said, God oppresses the proud, but gives grace to the humble. We got to get rid of our pride. Amen? Grace is the power of change. Amen? Praise God. And so with that, I'm getting ready to close for the day. Amen. I believe that we all need recovery. Everyone. And the only way we can get it is by putting forth our effort. To be honest and open.
Yes.
And in our celebrated recovery, we're going to experience that. Because people will be able to talk about it without condemnation, without judgment, and be able to get the freedom that they feel inside. We're going to give grace. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand to our feet today. Praise God. I hope this message has helped somebody as you look at life, problems, situations. How many do we cause ourselves by trying to be control things? What we need to do is just surrender to the Lord and allow the Lord to do what He needs to do within our life. This altar is open. If the singers would come, those that are singing, amen, during the altar call, praise God, hallelujah. And then you come. Find a place to pray. Find a place to seek God. Amen. God will bless you. Amen. Because of your openness before Him. Hallelujah. Almighty God, I thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
today that somebody got something out of that message. Amen. That they can begin to work on within their lives. Amen. I don't believe God wants His people to be broken.
Right.
God wants us to have the victory.
Yes. Amen.
In the name of Jesus, praise God. Hallelujah. Sean, come. Sean has an announcement concerning CSTI, which is our college course.
I actually have two different announcements. The first one is what Pastor said, the CSTI. If anyone is interested in signing up for it, it's enriching for sure. So if you are interested, come see me. There is a small fee for each trimester that we do. But like I said, it will bless you. You'll learn a lot, things that you didn't know. Thought you knew something, and then you find out, well, maybe I didn't know as much as I did. The second one is this Friday, the 15th, New Jersey, Delaware Youth and Hyphen Rally is at 7:30 p.m. at New Life Worship Center in Pennsville, New Jersey. That's 80 South Hook Road, Pennsville. If you have any questions on, if you forgot what I just said about the address or whatever, just come see me. I can give it to you so you can put it into your phone or your GPS, which is your computer's phone. And it should be good, and it's again, it's around the youth and the hyphen. And it's also posted in there if you want to take a picture of it. Keep it in your phone.
They're also allowing the younger children to, they have things set up for the younger children.
Yeah, there's a thing for the juniors.
Yeah, so everybody can attend.
Yeah. My wife will be needing prayer that night.
Amen.
Amen. Don't forget, if you want to get into CSTI,
yes.
See Sean, we'll give you a registration form. This is the college course curriculum. Amen. All physically based. It's a great course. Amen. Awesome teachers. Amen. And we do that Sundays after service in the fellowship hall. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. We'll see Sean. He'll give you the details. I believe it's $140 first trimester, so very well worth it. That is for sure. Amen. Praise God. Let's stand our feet for being dismissed. Amen. Father, we love you and we thank you so much, God, for your goodness, for your grace. Help us, Lord, to God, apply what we have heard today, God.
Yes, Lord.
We realize that, God, we are not in control, God, but you are. Help us to surrender to that, God. And help us, Lord, to call upon you in all things. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. You are dismissed in Jesus' name.